still continuing to talk about in the beginning today, and today's message is from blessings to bondage. Remember, the Israelites were in incredible blessings. They had it good in Egypt, right? Joseph was over, he was second in charge to everything, and God had just blessed Israel because of Joseph's faithfulness, and this is just an incredible thing. But now we're going to see that things can change. Things can turn around on a dime, right? How many of you have ever been going through life and everything been wonderful, and just like that, your world is rocked, and all of a sudden things aren't so wonderful? Well, the Israelites are going to experience some of that this week. In this week's reading, if you've been reading along with us, and I pray that you have, you'll see that things are changing drastically. But here's what we've got to go back to, Genesis chapter 12. We're going to be in Genesis chapter 50. I'm just going to read that. It's going to be on the screen. You don't have to go there. But Genesis chapter 12 said, "Now the Lord said to Abram, remember, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you, and I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing." Remember that way back when? Remember? God has made him a promise, right? Remember, God cannot lie. Right? Aren't you thankful? Jump to Genesis chapter 50, and we're going to go down and start with verse 18. Jacob, Israel, he's died. He just recently died. And remember, the brothers, a little scared of Joseph, because Joseph's got all the power in Egypt now except for Pharaoh. Pharaoh's the only one greater than he is in Egypt. And so now that daddy's gone, the brothers are thinking, what's brother going to do to us now? Is he going to get us back now that Papa's gone? Papa's not here to save us. Verse 18, his brothers also came and fell down before him and said, "Behold, we are your servants." Remember when that was foretold, that was going to happen? Now his brothers are bowing down to him. And in the dream that he had, remember, God said, this is what's going to happen. But Joseph said to them, "Do not fear, for am I in the place of God? As for you," and I love this. This is one of my favorite things in the whole Bible. "As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good." God is in control, people. Do you understand that? Do you trust him? It's almost like we trust him as long as everything's going the way we want it to go. But the moment things turn around, "Oh God, where are you? Oh, wherefore art thou?" You know, we get King Jamesy on him. "God, where hast thou goneth?" And he's the same as he was yesterday, the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's right where he's always been. And he's in control. "As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today. So do not fear, I will provide for you and your little ones." Thus be comforted. Thus he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. So Joseph remained in Egypt, he and his father's house. Joseph lived 110 years. How old was Joseph when he came into Egypt, when he was sold into slavery? Do you remember? About 17? How old was he when he gained control, when Potiphar put him in control of everything in Egypt? Do you remember? About 30-ish, remember? And now it's 80 years later. See, understand, when you're studying Scripture, remember, from one verse to the next verse can be a lot of years, right? I've had several questions this week, and you are asking good questions. If you have questions about what you're reading during BXP, we want to know about it because we want to help you. But sometimes as you read, you realize that there's a big span there, a big time frame, and it will change the way, it'll bring it into perspective if you can understand that. Because sometimes we look in and say, well, how did that happen? You know, we're just in the next verse, and sometimes it's years and years later. But anyway, Joseph lived 110 years, and Joseph said to his brothers, "I'm about to die, but God will visit you and bring you up out of this land to the land that he swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob." Remember, way back, that God had made a promise to Abram, correct? Egypt is not the promised land. I've got a feeling that some of the Israelites thought Egypt was the promised land because they had it pretty good there. Because Joseph is over everything, and he's taking care of his family, and they've got all the stuff they need. They've got all the food. Even in the times of drought, in the times of not plenty, they had everything that they needed. So I'm sure, I know, because as we get further into Exodus, we're going to see that a lot of them said, "Hey, why can't we just go back? We had it better there than what we've got it now." But understand this, And this is basically going to be the theme for the day. God had made a promise. The God who cannot lie had made a promise. God had made a promise and he had a plan. We're going to look at a summary of God's promises to Abraham real quickly. In Genesis 12, he made that promise, and we read it just a moment ago. All nations will be blessed in Abraham and his seed. All nations. Abraham and his seed are to possess the land forever. How long is forever? Now, there were times they were taken out of their land, but they have it back now. It's amazing. Abraham is to be the father of an innumerable seed. Do you realize that according to, let me look here and get this right, according to Galatians chapter 3, 29, it says, if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. My question to you is, are you Christ's? Do you belong to him? Then you're an heir to Abraham. You're an heir to the promise. So when God said he's going to bless all the nations and his seed's going to be an innumerable seed, we're part of that seed. So I guess we're kind of Hebrewish, technically. And then lastly, he said, Abraham is to be the father of a singular seed who will conquer all enemies. Who is that singular seed? Come on, don't be afraid to answer. Who is it? Jesus. He is the singular seed that is going to conquer all enemies. He hasn't done it yet, but he's still in control, right? God made a promise. Now, Israel has been blessed, and it's growing exponentially. Israel is growing like crazy. You know, it's like somebody put something in the water. You know, like they got a little rabbit in them or something. They're just shooting them out, spitting them out. And that brings us to our reading in Exodus today. Turn to Exodus chapter 1. We're going to start in verse 6. It says, then Joseph died, and all his brothers and all that generation. So here we're a few years later, right? We know that Joseph died at what age? 110. After he died, now it says that the rest of them that were there at that moment that came in to the land with Jacob and all of them, that generation, they've all died. But the people of Israel were fruitful and increased greatly. They're still just growing like crazy. They multiplied and grew exceedingly strong so that the land was filled with them. You've got Israelites running around everywhere. Verse 8, now there arose a new king over Egypt, who did not know Joseph. Very important little phrase there. This new king, this new Pharaoh, did not know Joseph. Probably heard about him. I don't know. Surely they had history. Probably knew some of the things that went on, but he's apparently not impressed. He apparently has no fear for this God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And so as we see, this new guy did not know Joseph. And he said to his people, behold, the people of Israel are too many and too mighty for us. He's starting to look at the situation. And he's starting to realize these people are getting big in number and they could cause us problem in the long run. He said, verse 10, come, let us deal shrewdly with them, lest they multiply. And if war breaks out, they join our enemies and fight against us and escape from the land. Therefore, they set taskmasters over them to afflict them with heavy burdens. They built for Pharaoh store cities, Pithom and Ramses. In other words, the new king says, we got to get them to work. All of a sudden now the blessings are going to be gone and now they're in bondage. The Bible foretold that they'd be in bondage in Egypt, right? We're going to talk about that timeline because most people think it's for 400 years and it's not. But we're going to get to that. And in a week or two, I'm going to break that down for you. It's a very interesting study. And it goes right along with Scripture, so I'm not going to tell you something new. I'm just going to tell you something that study shows and show you how to pick that out. But we've got the new Pharaoh that says all these Israelites are getting too big, they're getting too strong, and I'm starting to fear them because if our enemies come in, then these slaves that we now have are going to revolt against us, they're going to join forces with the enemy, and we're in trouble. So he's just thinking like a leader, right? He wants to protect his land, his homeland. He wants to protect his people. Verse 12, so they started making them do all these things. They started making them make their own bricks. They started making them use their own straw. They started making them go after their own straw, as you've read in your scripture this week. But the more they were oppressed, verse 12, the more they multiplied and the more they spread abroad. So Pharaoh's plan is not working, is it? See, he's supposed to make them so tired that when they get home at night, they don't want to procreate. It's in the scripture. I'm not saying anything bad. I mean, seriously. Can't be afraid to talk about these things. God's word talks about it all the time. And he's thinking, we'll just wear them down and wear them out because, you know, it'll just stop all this. As I need to stop right now. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and the more they spread abroad. And the Egyptians were in dread of the people of Israel. So they ruthlessly made the people of Israel work as slaves. They came down hard on them, from blessings to bondage. But, what's the theme for today? God made a promise, right? We've got to understand when God makes a promise, he cannot lie, and it's going to come about. So Pharaoh devised a plan to get rid of all male newborns. Remember, he told the Hebrew midwives, when there's a male born, we want you to do what? Kill it. Let's get rid of all those male babies. Remember later on in the future, this kind of happens again when Jesus is on the scene and they try to kill all the babies, the boys 2 years old and under. This is kind of a foreshadow of Jesus coming. So Pharaoh devised a plan, and he wanted the Hebrew midwives to be a part of it, but guess what? They wouldn't go along with it, would they? Why would they not go along with it? They feared God. There's a lot of things in life that we don't need to go along with because we fear God. You know, some of the new preaching and new teaching today is that God's grace is so, and it is, don't get me wrong, it is. But it's like it covers everything and we can do whatever we want. We can live however we want. We can treat people however we want to treat them. And God is obligated to bless us. Newsflash, no, he's not. He's not. These midwives feared God. When we have sin knocking at our door, when we have wrong knocking at our door, we need to fear God and say, I'm not giving in, no matter what the consequences. The scripture you were reading this morning with Paul, he took joy in his afflictions. He was going to stand up no matter what took place, knowing that one day he's probably going to be killed for his faith, but he didn't care because he loved God and he feared God. And we say we love him, but I think oftentimes we don't fear him. And we need to. Verse 22, then Pharaoh commanded all his people. He says, you know, that first plan was thwarted. And oh, by the way, did you read in there how the Hebrew midwives were blessed? God gave them families of their own. Why? Because they were faithful to him and they didn't bow to the king. They didn't bow to the forces outside saying you need to do this to be part of the world. No, they were willing, I guess, to lose their lives because they went against the king. God blessed them. God's got a way of blessing. You know it? You know it? You don't know it? You people, well, I tell you, it's true. Pharaoh commanded all of his people, every son that is born to the Hebrews you shall cast into the Nile, but you shall let every daughter live. He's like, okay, these Hebrew midwives are not going to work with me, so I'm just going to tell my people, when you see a newborn boy, ditch him. Throw him in the Nile. That's pretty cruel, isn't it? I think it's pretty cruel. So it looks like the Israelites were pretty much done because without boys, things just don't multiply, right? Yeah. So it looks like they were done. But what's our theme? God made a promise. I want you to catch this. Some of you, y'all should have it by now. What's our theme? God made a promise. Very good. And here's the thing as you go through Scripture and we look now, God has always had a redeemer at the right time. He's always had a person called out, set apart to rescue his people so that his promises from the get-go were going to come to pass. So those who really trusted and believed God weren't too concerned, I don't think. Exodus chapter 2, verse 1. Now a man from the house of Levi went and took as his wife a Levite woman. The woman conceived and bore a son, and when she saw that he was a fine child, she hid him 3 months. Now, is she supposed to be hiding this child? What's supposed to have happened to this child? Thrown in the Nile. You do know the Nile is famous for crocodiles, don't you? And I don't want to paint a nasty picture, but it's reality. You got a bunch of kids being thrown in the Nile. It's not a good thing. You know? It's not a good thing. Even if there's not crocodiles, I guess newborns thrown in the Nile is not a good thing, is it? Regardless. But this woman saw that she had a fine child. I don't know exactly what that means. I need to do a little more studying on that. But she hid him for 3 months. She's going against who? Pharaoh, the king. When she could hide him no longer, I guess he's growing up and he's probably crying and stuff. And by the way, I think in the Egyptian time, it took about 5 years to wean a child. I think they spent about 5 years weaning children. And so she could hide him no longer. She took for him a basket made of bulrushes and daubed it with bitumen and pitch. That's a little tar substance to keep things from leaking. She put the child in it and placed it among the reeds by the riverbank. She took her child, put him in a basket, and put him in the reeds in the Nile River. Do you think she's trusting God when she's doing this? Because she knows God is in control. And somewhere along the way, she's probably thinking back, God had made a promise, and we can trust him. So she put it among the reeds in the riverbank, and his sister stood at a distance to know what would be done to him. As you're reading this, get the picture. See his sister putting this basket with a baby in it in the reeds, and then going back wherever she went, watching to see what happens to her little brother. Do you think it excited her to take her brother and put him in a basket and put him in the reeds in the Nile River? No. There's a good chance that her little brother's going to die. Either a croc's going to get him, or the Egyptians are going to kill him, right? So they don't like his chances probably, but they're still trusting God. And we can trust God with our most dire circumstances. I don't care what you're going through. I don't care what you will go through. You can trust God in it and through it. Verse 5, now the daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river, while her young women walked beside the river. I don't know if her young women were walking beside the river because they were supposed to be the croc bait in case the crocs came up hungry. I don't know. But I'm sure that happened. But they were walking beside the river. She saw the basket among the reeds, sent her servant woman, and she took it. When she opened it, she saw the child, and behold, the baby was crying. She took pity on him and said, this is one of the Hebrew children. Now, at that moment, she could have had him killed, right? And that would have been the end of that. But what had God done previously? He made a promise. And apparently Moses is his little dude that he's going to use. And so Moses is going to be taken care of. Then his sister, Moses' sister, said to Pharaoh's daughter, I love this, shall I go and call you a nurse from the Hebrew women to nurse the child for you? And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, go. So the girl went and called Moses' mother. This is an incredible story to me. Here was a woman who was faithful. She didn't give up her child. But when it came time that she knew something had to be done, she was trusting God with her little boy. And God was very faithful. When Pharaoh's daughter found him, they could have put Moses to death at that moment. But they didn't. So then she goes and gets mom. Can you imagine what she must have said to her mom? Mom, you're not going to believe this. By the way, they found Moses. But you're not going to believe this. And mom's probably, what have they done? Pharaoh's daughter wants you to come and nurse your son. I've never been a mom. Okay, Captain Obvious. But I can only imagine what was going through mom's mind at this time. When you're reading scripture, you're not changing scripture to sit there and try to imagine what must have been happening in her mind. That's why I tell you, don't just gloss over it and run through it and hit and go to the next chapter so you can hurry up and get it done. I'd rather you be way behind than just done. If you're way behind because you just can't get out of it. It's like, I got to go over this again because this is just incredible. So Pharaoh's daughter said to her, take this child away and nurse him for me, and I'll give you your wages. I want to pay you to go nurse your child. Wow. I think it's pretty incredible, don't you? Come on, people, wake up. You're not having as much fun with this as I am. It's incredible. Take the child, nurse him for me, and I'll give you your wages. So the woman took the child and nursed him. Duh. When the child grew older, she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. Now, in the process, do you think she may have been Mrs. Moses? You think she may have been telling Moses along the way about some of the Hebrew culture? Possibly. Maybe teaching him the language? Sure. And he's growing up understanding both cultures, but he hasn't been given over yet to Pharaoh's daughter, right? So he's not really been a part of the palace just yet, I don't guess. But in the meantime, his mom is probably teaching him and probably whispering little things and like, Moses, I know God can make you remember this, but way back when, God made this man named Abraham a promise. And I don't know if you're part of that promise, but I sure like what I'm seeing God doing with you. And so as you go and you serve in Pharaoh's court, that's how we know Tennis was back in those days, because Moses served in Pharaoh's court. But as you go back and you look, and as you go over there, I want you to remember some of the things that I've told you. I'm just imagining. That's okay. So she named him Moses because she said, I drew him out of the water. That's how he got his name, to be drawn out, to be called away, Moses. Now, here's a few little tidbits that we've got to remember. Moses was born 64 years after the death of Joseph, okay? So Joseph has been gone a long time. We see one verse, then we go to another verse, and we go to three or four verses, and boom, here's Moses. It's 64 years later after Joseph has died. We've got a new king on the scene. Didn't really know Joseph. Maybe had heard about him, but all he's knowing is those people are getting too plentiful for us, and we've got to wipe them out. Or at least get them down manageable so they can still serve us, but not grow so they can be against us. Moses lived for 40 years in Pharaoh's house before being exiled in the desert. Remember, he killed an Egyptian. But he had been in Pharaoh's house for 40 years. Do you think he learned the customs? Sure he did. You think he knew everything that was going on? Sure he did. Do you think that there might have been times that he remembered what this woman who had nursed him had told him as he's out dealing with the Egyptians and the Hebrews? Do you think there might have been? I think so. Do you think God was able to call to his memory the things that he had been told and taught by his mom? Probably. We know he could. The Bible says that he then went to be with his people, the Israelites, where he lived for 40 more years. So how old is Moses at this point? He's 80 years old. You see, sometimes we think we get to a point where we're too old to be used. I don't care how old you are in here, you're not too old to be used. If you're here today and you're breathing, God's not done with you. If you're here today and you're breathing, God still has a purpose and a plan for you. Do you believe that? I see too many people who feel like they have no purpose. And so we just go out and we destroy our lives. We throw them away. We go living like the world. And we never accomplish all that God has for us and what he desires for us. So he went to be with his people for 40 years. Now in chapter 3 of Exodus, after 80 years, God was ready to use Moses to free his people from the bondage of Egypt, right? We're going to get into all that this week's reading. And you're going to see some incredible things take place. And you're going to have a lot of questions, and I encourage you to ask us those questions. We may come up with, I don't know, where's Ian? Is Ian in here? He may be back playing with the kids. Probably we're going to set up a place for you to go, maybe on Facebook or something, just to ask a question. Okay? And we'll get some good discussion going. But here's the thing. God always has a redeemer. God had made a promise. God cannot lie. You see, Joseph's brothers wanted to kill him, but they didn't, right? Why? Why? What's our theme? God had made a promise. After Mrs. Potiphar's accusations, Joseph should have been put to death, but he wasn't. Why? You guys pick up fast. After Joseph's death, the new king in Egypt wanted to destroy all the male children born to the Israelites, but he couldn't. Why? God had made a promise. I'm sure a bunch of those kids died, but God had made a promise. And God only needs one person to work in and through to accomplish his will. And he wants to use me and he wants to use you. And we need to be usable of God. So in our reading now, we're going to get to the point where Moses proclaims, I can't lead Israel out of Egypt. Who am I? But he can. Why? Why? Because it made a promise. And as we've noted many, many times, when God makes a promise, you can count on it coming to pass. So as we continue reading this week and on in through Exodus, there's going to be a lot of stuff. Don't get mired down with the things that you don't understand, but write notes, ask questions, okay? But as you read, I want you to see the power of God. You're going to have questions. Why did God do this? Why did God allow that? And those are legitimate questions, but there are answers for those questions, and we'll get into them over the next couple of weeks. But as we've noticed, when God makes a promise, you can count on it to come to pass. And I want us to look at four verses in the New Testament quickly. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5. Quoting what came out of Deuteronomy. For he has said, God has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Is that a promise? Is that a promise? Can you count on it? Yes, you can. So whatever you're going through now, whatever your dark times are that you may be going through, God has not left you. Maybe God's trying to strengthen you. Maybe God's trying to develop character in you. Maybe God's trying to form you into the person that he needs you to be because he knows what the next step is and he needs you to be ready. Maybe. Then Romans 8:28, a very familiar verse with most, says, and we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. I don't know if you remember a couple years ago, we spent a lot of time just on that verse. Remember the cake analogy? All things work together for good. Remember, the cake, you've got all these ingredients, and the majority of the ingredients you wouldn't eat by themselves. I don't know too many people is going to get them a handful of flour and eat it. Flour, and eat it. I've seen some whacked out kids and stuff in my days, but not too many people take handfuls of salt. Maybe you do and you shouldn't. But maybe you do and you eat a handful of salt. I don't know too many people who take the little bottle of vanilla and just chug a drink. Some of you, and I have before, but it's not really good. Raw eggs, probably not the greatest thing in the world. Right? Maybe a little sugar, but you're not going to eat tons of it because it'll make you sick. Milk's good. I like milk with stuff. Not by itself, but with stuff. So you take a cake, and before it's prepared, before it's made, you got all these ingredients that in and of themselves are not really good by themselves, right? Right? And remember what happens when you take all those not-so-good ingredients and you put them together and you follow the instructions, what happens? You get a delicious cake. God can cause all things, all the bad things, all the whatever things in your life to work together for good if you love him. I look at my life and I look at all the junk that I've been through and all the hurt and all the devastation, and it's helped to make me who I am today. My faith is strong because of the weak things back those days, right? So don't give up. Don't give in. Don't follow the king because the king doesn't like you. Follow the king because he loves you. Don't give in to the world and the world's way of doing things because the world hates the God that you say you love. And the Bible even tells us don't love the world or the things that are in the world. If any man loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. So we need to get our focus on God and trust that everything that's happened to us and everything that we're going through now, he can use to make a sweet, delicious cake out of, right? Do you believe that? Some of you don't believe that. Some of you are going through stuff right now and you don't believe that. You say, this ingredient I don't like. It's one of the ingredients that's got to come together to make you the best you can be. I don't get it. I wish God didn't do some of the things that he does or didn't allow some of the things that he allows. I wish he did things differently, but he's God and he's chosen the way he wants to do it, and he can do it because he's God. Philippians 4, 7. Verse 6 says, what does it say? In everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Then he goes on to say, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Bless you. So we need to be praying. We need to be petitioning God. We need to be talking to him and believing him and trusting him. And then he says this peace that only he can truly give, the peace that we can't even imagine because it surpasses all of our understanding. It'll guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. Is that a promise from God? I lean on that promise often because things aren't always the way I want them. My body doesn't always feel the way I want it to feel. I am getting older. I am slowing down. But I'm just one breath closer to heaven. So it's about perspective. And that brings me peace. And that brings me joy. Tom and I were talking this morning as we were praying over the service. And you know, it's a great thing to be ready to meet the Lord. My question to you is, are you ready? If Jesus were to return right now, are you ready? When you lay your head on your pillow tonight, are you okay with the Lord saying, I'm ready for you? There's peace and there's joy in being able to lay down and say to yourself and to God, if you're ready for me, I'm ready. And that's a peace that passes all understanding. And then finally, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Is that a promise from God? Yes, it's a promise from God. And we need to be living that promise in front of people that they'll know that we truly believe what we say we believe. God had a plan, right? God made a promise, right? God cannot lie, can he? God's in control, isn't he? We need to trust him, don't we? We need to be who he's called us to be in this. You are the only you in the world. Pretty profound, isn't it? There's nobody else that can be you. You're that little snowflake that's unlike any others. You're that little thumbprint that nobody else has. And God desires to use you for his purpose. God made a promise way back then. God had a plan way back then. And his plan is being fulfilled today. And we need to go out and live like we believe that. Would you agree? So let's do it. This promise of Jesus actually started, we first heard about it in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. When Jesus talked about the serpent and the heel, he'll bruise your heel, but you'll crush his head with your heel. He's talking about Jesus. So the promise that God made back then is going to come to pass. And we need to trust it. Let's bow our heads.